So good afternoon, everybody. Hello, namaskar. So we have in this panel, what we would like to do is to, we have three other panels that we have so far. In this panel, we will try to keep this discussion around biodiversity and in climate resilience. In climate resilience, mainly how resilience about species around ecosystems. So that it decides in this area. So we have people who have decades of experience in biodiversity, in the issues of understanding the landscapes of South Asia. So I would like to first ask Professor Uma Ramakrishnan. We always call her Uma. So I would ask Uma that she was my one of the first research mentors in her lab. I worked with her. So I want to ask Uma that recently, by the way, there is a book I think I strongly recommend to all of you to visit the book and borrow it or buy it, and read Woman in the Wild. It and because there's so many students are here, it's about stories of women scientists, conservationists, people who are working with animals, plants in India. And it's about their work. And Uma, because of her decades of work in mammals, particularly tiger and leopard, carnivores, and various other systems. I mean, one part of Uma is also that she was very interested in work on museum systems, isn't it? So one can think of not just biodiversity in what we see in the field, what we see around us, but also what is there in the museums, what is there in the herbarium, and so on. So I request you to find the book, and I would like to ask Uma first that, you know, see, this biodiversity is there in from school textbooks to university textbooks in here. And when, to be honest, when it's me, we have this thing about biodiversity, it seems like very textbookish, right? So for you, what, like, how did you get into this? She was a graduate in physics in IIT, right? So but she's now working on pools, you know, mostly. Mostly. So what, how do you see this?
Yeah, so thanks, Shubho, and hi, everyone. Really nice to be here. So, like Shubho says, biodiversity, when you think of it, you know, it's something which you, whether you feel like you can experience it, right? And there's so much of discussion about climate change and what we just heard. I don't know what you guys feel, but it all sounds very gloomy, right? Like, there's just no future and it's all very depressing. But I think that maybe that is true in some sense. But I think that it's ultimately biodiversity is also about our relationship to nature. And understanding it cannot be through textbooks. It has to be some connection which we have with nature. I think it's a very individual experience, very unique experience. So like people say that about parenting also, you know, or even friendship, say, you know, only you know what some person means to you, right? And it's a very unique feeling, like you can't really explain it, or, you know. So similarly with nature, you know, it's a very unique experience, the way we experience biodiversity. And it's ultimately that we love biodiversity. So the scientific arguments, you know, about resilience and climate and all that stuff are, of course, very valid, but clearly they're not working, right? So we've known, I mean, amazingly, since the 1970s, that's when a lot of legislation to protect biodiversity came into place. CITES, Wildlife Protection Act, so many things like that. There were some wonderful books written internationally about the value of nature and so on. But if you look at the data, it is from the 1970s where we are seeing this dramatic decline. We are seeing these extinctions and so on and so forth. So there may be intent, like science can provide us evidence and all that stuff, but ultimately I think I mean, maybe this sounds a little too crazy, but I think there has to be a revolution, individual revolution. Like all of you have to individually care about biodiversity, and only then is there something that's is going to change.
I want to ask one specific question that, you know, at some point in time in Central India, we had rhinos, we had lions, so on. Of course, cheetah was there until very recently. But it's no longer there. The Central Indian landscape is completely changed, it's dry and so on. So, since you have worked on tigers, you have worked on leopards and various other systems, what do you see the signature of the past biodiversity in the present populations that possibly would be interesting for people to get that what we see in the past is that if tigers are there only in Bandipur, it's not just only in Bandipur, they are connected, they were there on other places. So what do you see?
Yeah, so that's a very interesting question. I think that a lot of times the vegetation of the past, you know, the fact that Central India was more of a grassland, and that's why they had, how do we even know that? Based on fossil records, right? So when we look at fossils from a place like Karnool, which is very close to here, maybe 3 or 4 hours from here, it's really hot today, there's a lot of caves there. In fact, if you go to Karnool, you'll see a lot of mining. It's big mining area. But if you look at those deposits, in those caves, you'll find remains of rhinos and many grassland associated species. As far as something like tigers are actually very flexible species, I would say, generalists, right? They, wherever there is prey, they will live, and they can live. But the fact that, you know, the vegetation in Central India reflects the past, but I think we should also be very clear. There was we were hearing an introduction about these protected spaces and so on. I think we should be very, very clear that humans have impacted most of the earth, changed most of it. So there's nothing natural as such. So maybe this is, again, I don't know how popular a view this is. We always want to have some pristine, lovely thing, and there's no such thing. All ecosystems have been modified. And so we can also think about the future as a place where we are trying to aim for biodiversity, like survival, for climate resilience, from a selfish perspective, like a human selfish perspective. That's, you know, that's something which I don't know whether that's okay or not, but yeah.
So actually, see, we need this place around which there are wildlife. But it's the Everest Finding City, Bangalore. So we have, from Wildlife Conservation Group, we have Swami Prakash and Ashoka, who have worked in this landscape where, living in Bangalore, you will see that, oh, wildlife must be in Bandipur. So, but Areli can Samarit. They are working here, and they are seeing this situation of a city is expanding. And as one said, all ecosystems have been modified, but its modification rate is perhaps much faster. So, Nandi Avanta Krishni, the new leaf is Samantira, in the wildlife biodiversity. So, Nima experience in the Bandipur National Park, how the city is expanding, city is impacting the biodiversity of Bandipur National Park. And what it means, urban ecology is an important issue. It's coming again and again. So, Nindakarai, how does this impact the urban ecology? Can it be also thought as urban ecology again that it's expanding, the city is expanding?
I'm studying, well, turn to that. Okay. ನಾನು ಇಲ್ಲೇ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರು ಪಕ್ಕದಲ್ಲೇ ಬಣ್ಣೇರು ಘಟ್ಟ ತಟ್ಟಳಿಗೆ ಹೋಗಿಲ್ಲ. ಇಲ್ಲಿ ನನಗೆ ಬಣ್ಣೇರು ಘಟ್ಟ ನ್ಯಾಷನಲ್ ಪಾರ್ಕ್ ಅದು ಪಕ್ಕನೇ ಮನೆ. ಬಣ್ಣೇರು ಘಟ್ಟ ನ್ಯಾಷನಲ್ ಪಾರ್ಕ್ ಅಂದ ತಕ್ಷಣವೇ ಇದೊಂದು ತುಂಬ ಹತ್ರ ಇರೋ ಒಂದು ಮೆಟ್ರೋಪಾಲಿಟನ್ ಸಿಟಿಗೆ ತುಂಬ ಹತ್ರ ಇರೋವಂಥ ಒಂದು ಮಹಾನ. ನಮ್ಮ ತಾತಂದಿರೆಲ್ಲ ಹಿಂದೆ ಹುಟ್ಟಿ ಬೆಳೆದಿದ್ರು. ಆಗಿನ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರೇ ಬೇರೆ ಥರ ಇತ್ತು. ಸೊ ನಮಗೆಲ್ಲ ಸ್ಟೋರೀಸ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ತುಂಬ ಹೇಳ್ತಿ ಬರ್ತದೆ. ಸೊ ನಾನು ಸಣ್ಣವನಿದ್ದಾಗ ಬಣ್ಣೇರು ಘಟ್ಟ ಕಾಡಿಸಿ ನೀವೆಲ್ಲ ಓದಿಬೋದು ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಡೈ ಡೆಸಿಡಿಯಸ್ ಪಾಸ್ ಎಷ್ಟೊಂದು ಜನ ಬಯಾಲಜಿಕಲ್ ಝೂ ಇದೆ ಅದನ್ನೇ ನಾವು ನ್ಯಾಷನಲ್ ಪಾರ್ಕ್ ಅಂತ ಅನ್ಕೋಬಿಟ್ಟಿದ್ದೀವಿ. ಆ್ಯಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಅದೆಲ್ಲ ಬಣ್ಣೇರು ಘಟ್ಟ ರಾಷ್ಟ್ರೀಯ ಉದ್ಯಾನವನ ಅನ್ನೋದು ತುಂಬ ದೊಡ್ಡ ಇದೆ. 265 ಸ್ಕ್ವೇರ್ ಕಿಲೋಮೀಟರ್ ಅಷ್ಟು ದೊಡ್ಡದಾಗಿ ಆನೆಗಳಿಗೆ ಒಳ್ಳೆಯ ಹೆಸರು ಉಟ್ಕೊಂಡಿಲ್ಲ. ನಮ್ಮ ಅಜ್ಜಿ ತಾತ ಹೇಳಿದ ಸ್ಟೋರಿಗಳಿಗೂ ಮತ್ತೆ ಹಾಗೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ನಾವು ನೋಡಿದ್ದು ಬಣ್ಣೇರು ಘಟ್ಟ ಜಾಗ. ಆದ್ರೆ ಇಷ್ಟೊಂದು ವೆಜಿಟೇಷನ್ ಈ ತರ ಇರ್ಲಿಲ್ಲ, ಕಡಿಮೆ ಆಲ್ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ ಗ್ರಾಸ್ ಲೈನ್ ತರನೇ ಇತ್ತು. ತುಂಬ ಕುರ್ಚಿ ಕಾಡಿತ್ತು. ನೀವು ಅವಾಗ ತೋಳ ನೋಡ್ಬೋದಿತ್ತು, ಹೈನ ನೋಡ್ಬೋದಿತ್ತು, ಎಷ್ಟೊಂದು ವಲ್ಚರ್ಸ್ ನೋಡ್ಬೋದಿತ್ತು ಬಣ್ಣೇರು ಘಟ್ಟ. ಆದ್ರೆ ಯಾವಾಗ 1973 ಬಣ್ಣೇರು ಘಟ್ಟ ನ್ಯಾಷನಲ್ ಪಾರ್ಕ್ ಆಗಿ ಡಿಕ್ಲೇರ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಆಗ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಪ್ರೊಟೆಕ್ಷನ್ ಸಿಕ್ತು ಅದಕ್ಕೆ. ಆನಂತರ ಇಲ್ಲಿನ ಅಲ್ಲಿಂದು ಸಸ್ಯವರ್ಗ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿ ಬೆಳೆದಿದ್ದು ಬೆಳೆದಿದ್ದು ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಅದು ಸುಮ್ಮನೆ ಹಂಗೆ ಬಂದ್ಬಿಡೋಲ್ಲ. ಗ್ರಾಸ್ಲ್ಯಾಂಡು ಒಳ್ಳೆ ವೆಜಿಟೇಷನ್ ಇರೋಂತ ಕಾಡು ಹಾಕಕ್ಕೆ ಹಾಗೆ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಆಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ. ಅದಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಹಿಂದೆ ನಾವು ಹಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿ ತಗೊಂಡ್ರೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಕುರಿ ತಂದೆ ಒಂದು ನಾವು ಇಷ್ಟೊಂದು ಚಿನ್ಕೋ ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಅಲ್ಲ ಸಾರಿ ಕೆನೆತ ಡ್ರೆಸ್ ಅನ್ನ ಕತೆಗಳು ಓದ್ಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಊರ ಪಕ್ಕನೇ ಒಂದು ಉಕ್ಕಿಕೋನ ಅಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ ಇದೆ, ಒಂದು ಸ್ಟ್ರೀಂಗ್ ಇದೆ. ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಕೆನೆತ ಡ್ರೆಸ್ ಅನ್ನು ಹೋಗಿ ಹುಲಿ ಹಿಡಿದಿದ್ದಂತೆ. ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಆ ಹಳ್ಳಕ್ಕೆ ಹುಲಿ ಬೋರಳ್ಳ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಅದಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಹಿಂದೆ ಒಂದು ಹುಲಿ ವಾಸ ಮಾಡ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಜಾಗ ಅದು. ಅಂತ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಒಂದು ಹುಲಿ ವಾಸ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದೆ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಏನೆಲ್ಲ ಇರಬೇಕು. ಒಂದು ಹುಲಿ ಬಗ್ಸ್ಬೇಕಂದ್ರೆ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಎಷ್ಟೊಂದು ಜಿಂಕೆ ಇರಬೇಕು, ಎಷ್ಟೊಂದು ಕಾಟಿ ಇರಬೇಕು, ಎಷ್ಟೊಂದು ಸಾಂಬಾರ್ ನೀರು ಇರಬೇಕು, ಏನೆಲ್ಲ ಇರಬೇಕಪ್ಪ. ಅದೆಲ್ಲ ಇರಬೇಕಂದ್ರೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಕಾಡು ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಆಗಿರೋಕ್ಕೆ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಇರಬೇಕು. ದೊಡ್ಡ ಕಾಡೇ ಇರಬೇಕು, ದೊಡ್ಡ ಕಾಡು ಕೂಡ ಇತ್ತು ಅದು, ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಹುಲಿ ಇತ್ತು. ಆದರೆ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರು ಯಾವಾಗ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಬರ್ತಾ ಇದೆ ಅಂದವಾಗ ಇವಾಗ ನಮ್ಮ ಅಜ್ಜಿ ಹೇಳಿದೆ, ನಮ್ಮ ಅಜ್ಜಿಗೆ ಮನೆ ಬಂದ್ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಬಿಳೇಗಳಿ ಹತ್ರ ಕಾಡು ಬಿಳೇಕಳಿ ಅಂತ ಹೆಸರು ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಕೇಳಿದ್ರ ಕಾಡು ಬಿಳೇಕಳಿ ಅಂತ ಹೆಸರು. ಅವ್ರು ಹೇಳ್ತಿದ್ರು ಕಾಡು ಅನ್ನೋದು ಮಳೆ ಅಷ್ಟು ದೂರ ಇದ್ದಿದ್ದಲ್ಲ, ಇದನ್ನ ಬಿಳೇಕಡಿ ಜೆ ಪಿ ನಗರ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಆಡಿದ್ದು ಅವ್ರು ನೋಡಿದ್ದು ಕಾಡು. ನಾವು ಎರಡನೇ ತಲೆಮಾರಿಗೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಇವತ್ತು ನಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿ ಕೂಡ ಕಾಡು ನೋಡೋಕೆ ತುಂಬ ಕಷ್ಟ ಆಗಿದೆ. ಬಣ್ಣೇರು ಘಟ್ಟ ನ್ಯಾಷನಲ್ ಪಾರ್ಕ್ನ ಅದರ ಅಕ್ಕಪಕ್ಕ ಎಷ್ಟೊಂದು ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಆಕ್ಟಿವಿಟೀಸ್ ನಡೀತಾ ಇದೆ, ಅದ್ರ ಮೇಲೆ ಎಷ್ಟೊಂದು ನಾವು ಫೈಟ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಉಳಿಸ್ಕೋಬೇಕಾಗೋ ಪರಿಸ್ಥಿತಿ ಬಂದಿದೆ. ಆದರೆ ಸೊ ಯಾವಾಗ 1973 ಬಣ್ಣೇರು ಘಟ್ಟ ರಾಷ್ಟ್ರೀಯ ಉದ್ಯಾನವನ ಆಗಿ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಡ್ತು ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಪ್ರೊಟೆಕ್ಷನ್ ಸಿಕ್ತು. ಸೊ ಆಮೇಲೆ ವೆಜಿಟೇಷನ್ನು ಎಲ್ಲ ಕಡೆ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿ ಕವರ್ ಆಯ್ತಾ ಬಂತು. ಈಗ ಕಾಡಲ್ಲಿ ಸುತ್ತಮುತ್ತ ಇರೋ ಹಳ್ಳಿಗಳು ಜನ ಕೂಡ ದನ ಎಲ್ಲ ಕಾಡು ಒಳಗಡೆ ತೊಗೊಂಡೋಗಿಲ್ಲ, ಅಷ್ಟು ಪ್ರೊಟೆಕ್ಷನ್ ಇದೆ ಇವತ್ತು. ಸೊ ಇವತ್ತು ಮತ್ತೆ ನಾವು ಆನೆ ನೋಡ್ತಿದ್ದೀವಿ, ಜಿಂಕೆಗಳು ನೋಡ್ತಿದ್ದೀವಿ, ಸಾಂಬಾರ್ಡೀಸ್ ನೋಡ್ತಿದ್ದೀವಿ, ಇವನ್ ಒಂದು ಟೈಗರ್ ಕೂಡ ಇದೆ. ಸುಮಾರು 8 ವರ್ಷಗಳಿಂದ ಅದೇ ಒಂದು ಟೈಗರ್ ಇದೆ ಬಣ್ಣೇರು ಘಟ್ಟ ಕಾಡಲ್ಲಿ. ಅಂದರೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ನಾವು ಹೋಗ್ತಿದ್ದೀವಿ, ಆ ಥರ ಒಂದು ವೆಜಿಟೇಷನ್ ಪ್ಯಾಟರ್ನ್ ಇದೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಹತ್ರ ಅಂತ ಒಂದು ಗುರುವ. ಸೊ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರು ಯಾವಾಗ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಬೆಳೀತಾ ಇದೆ, ಇದೊಂದು ಕೆಪಾಸಿಟಿ ಇಷ್ಟೊಂದು ಬೇಕಾಗಿಲ್ಲ ಇವರು. ನಾವು ಈ ಮೊನ್ನೆಯೆಲ್ಲ ವಿಚಾರ ಕೇಳಿದ್ದೀವಿ, ಸ್ಟ್ರೈಕ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ವಿ ಕಾವೇರಿ ನೀರು ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಎಲ್ಲ. ಸೊ ನಮ್ಮದು ತುಂಬ ಸಣ್ಣ ಜನನ ಸಾಕುವಂಥ ಒಂದು ಬೆಂಗಳೂರಿದು, ಇಷ್ಟು ಜನ ಬೇಕಾಗಿದೆ, ಇಷ್ಟು ಜನ ಸಾಕೋ ಜಾಗನೂ ಅಲ್ಲ ಇದು. ಈಗಾಗಲೇ ನಾವು ಕಾವೇರಿಯಿಂದ 5 ಲೈನು ವಾಟ್ರ್ ದೊಡ್ಡ ಪೈಪ್ ನಾವು ಇದ್ಕೊಟ್ರೆ ಹಿಂಗೆ ಮುಟ್ಬೋದು, ಸ್ಟಿಕ್ಟ್ರವಾದ ಪೈಪ್ಗಳನ್ನ ಹಾಕಿ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರಿಗೆ ನೀರು ತಂದಿದ್ದೀವಿ. ನಾವು ಏನು ಕೊಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೀವಿ ಅಲ್ಲಿಗೆ, ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಗರೀಸು ಮಾಡಿದ ನೀರನ್ನ ವಾಪಸ್ ಕೊಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೀವಿ. ಸೊ ಈ ಇಶ್ಯೂ ಯಾವ ಥರ ಅಂದರೆ, ನಾವು ಸ್ಟ್ರೈಕ್ ಮಾಡೋದ್ರಿಂದ ನಮಗೆ ನೀರು ಸಿಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ, ನಾವು ಸ್ಟ್ರೈಕ್ ಮಾಡೋದ್ರಿಂದ ಗಲಾಟೆ ಮಾಡೋದ್ರಿಂದ ನಮ್ಗೇನು ಸಿಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ. ಆ್ಯಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಬೇಕಾಗಿರೋದು ವೆಸ್ಟರ್ನ್ ಗಾರ್ಡ್ಸ್ ಇದೆಯಲ್ಲ, ವೆಸ್ಟರ್ನ್ ಗಾರ್ಡ್ಸ್ನ ಉಳಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡ್ರೆ ಎಂಟೈರ್ ಸೌತ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ ಉಳ್ದಂಗೆ. ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಮಳೆ ಬಿದ್ದರೆ ನಮಗೆಲ್ಲಕ್ಕೂ ಮಳೆ ನೀರು, ಮನೆಗೆ ಆಗಲಿ, ಅಗ್ರಿಕಲ್ಚರ್ಗಾಗಲಿ, ನಿಮ್ಮ ಇಂಡಸ್ಟ್ರಿ ಏನು ಬೆಳೀತಾ ಇದೆ ಅದಕ್ಕಾಗಲಿ, ಪ್ರತಿಯೊಂದಕ್ಕೂ ಅಷ್ಟೇ. ಎಲ್ಲ ಜನ ಬರ್ತಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಅಂದರೆ ವೆಸ್ಟರ್ನ್ ಗಾರ್ಡ್ಸ್ ಬೇಕು, ಇಲ್ಲಾಂದರೆ ಇಲ್ಲ. ಸೊ ನಿಮ್ಗೆಲ್ಲ ಬಂತು ಪಶ್ಚಿಮ ಘಟ್ಟಗಳು ಯಾವ ಥರ ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡ್ತಾಯಿದ್ರು ಅಂದ್ರೆ, ಒಂದು ಲೈಕ್ ಅದು ಸ್ಪಾಂಜ್ ಥರ, ಮಳೆ ಬಿದ್ದರೆ ಅದನ್ನು ಹಿಡಿದಿಟ್ಕೊಂಡು ವರ್ಷ ಪೂರ್ತಿ ಸ್ಲೋವಾಗಿ ನೀರು ಕೊಡುತ್ತೆ. ಸೊ ಅದು ಸಣ್ಣ ಸಣ್ಣ ಸ್ಟ್ರೀಮಲ್ಲಿ ನೀರು ಜಿರುಗಿ ಒಂದು ಹಳ್ಳ ಆಗಿ, ಆಮೇಲೆ ಒಂದು ಉಪನದಿ ಆಗಿ, ಆಮೇಲೆ ನದಿ ಆಗಿ ಹರಿಯುತ್ತೆ. ಅವಧಿಕೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಡ್ಯಾಮ್ಗಳು, ಚೆಕ್ ಡ್ಯಾಮ್ಗಳು ಎಲ್ಲ ತಕ್ಕೊಂಡು ಎಲ್ಲ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ದೀವಿ. ಸರಿನಾ? ಸೊ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರು ಬೆಳೆಯುವಂಥದ್ದು ನಮಗೆ ಖುಷಿ ಕೊಡ್ಬೋದು. ಮೆಟ್ರೋಪಾಲಿಟನ್ ಸಿಟಿ ಸಕತ್ತಾಗಿದೆ, ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಮೆಗಾಪಾಲಿಟನ್ ಸಿಟಿ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ, ಎಷ್ಟೊಂದು ಕೆಲಸ ಸಿಗುತ್ತೆ, ಅವೆಲ್ಲ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿ ಓದಿರ್ಬೋದು ಅಂತ ನಿಜ, ಅವೆಲ್ಲ ಕನಸು ಅಷ್ಟೇ. ಸೊ ನಾವು ಮಾಡಬೇಕಾಗಿರೋ ಕೆಲಸ ಇಷ್ಟೇ. ಪಶ್ಚಿಮ ಘಟ್ಟಗಳನ್ನ ಉಳಿಸೋ ಕೆಲಸ ಏನಾದರೂ ಮಾಡಿದರೆ ಖಂಡಿತ ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿ ಬದುಕ್ಬೋದು. ನಾವೇನು ಅನ್ನ ಬೆಳ್ಕೊಳ್ಳೋಷ್ಟು ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿ ಬದುಕ್ಬೋದು ಎಲ್ಲರೂ. ವೆರಿ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಅನ್ನ, ಅದಿಲ್ಲ ಅಂದರೆ ತುಂಬ ಕಷ್ಟ. ನಾವು ಮೂಟೆ ದುಡ್ಡು ತೊಗೊಂಡೋಗಿ ಒಂದಷ್ಟು ಚಿನ್ನ ತೊಗೊಂಡು ಸುದ್ದು ಒಂದು ಕಾಲಕ್ಕೆ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಊಟ ಸಿಗಲ್ಲ, ರೈತರು ಇಲ್ಲ ಅಂದರೆ ಅದು ನಮ್ಮ ತಲೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಇರಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನೋದು. ಸೊ ಬಳ್ಳಾರಿ ಘಟ್ಟ ಸುತ್ತಮುತ್ತ ಇವತ್ತು ಏನು ಒಂದು ಎತ್ತ ಇಟ್ಟಿವಿ, ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಸೆಟಲೈಟ್ ಟೌನ್ಸ್ ಏನು ಪ್ಲಾನಿಂಗ್ ಆಗಿದೆ ಈಗ, ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಒಂದು ಪೆರಿಪೀರಿಯಲ್ ರಿಂಗ್ ರೋಡ್ ಅಂತ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಸೊ ಹೊಸೂರು ಆ ಕಡೆ, ರಾಮನಗರ, ಹೊಸಕೋಟೆ, ಸೊ ಈ ಥರ. ಸೊ ನಮ್ಮ ಬಳ್ಳಾರಿ ಘಟ್ಟ ನ್ಯಾಷನಲ್ ಪಾರ್ಕ್ ಆಗಿ ಹೋಗುತ್ತೆ ಆ ರಿಂಗ್ ರೋಡ್. ಮೊನ್ನೆ ತಾನೇ ಅಪ್ರೂವಲ್ ಕೊಟ್ಟರು, ವೈಲ್ಡ್ ಬೋರ್ಡ್ ಮೀಟಿಂಗಲ್ಲಿ ಅಪ್ರೂವಲ್ ಕೊಟ್ಟರು ಅದು. ಸೊ ಎಲಿವೇಟೆಡ್ ಕಾರಿಡಾರ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರಂತೆ. ಸೊ ವೆಹಿಕಲ್ಸ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಮೇಲೆ ಹೋಗ್ತಾವೆ, ಪ್ರಾಣಿಗಳೆಲ್ಲ ಕರಿಯೋ ಅಮ್ಮಿ. ಆ ಕನ್ಸ್ಟ್ರಕ್ಷನ್ ನಾಳೆ ಹಿಂಗೆ ನಡಿಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಎಷ್ಟೆಲ್ಲ ಸಮಸ್ಯೆಗಳಾಗ್ತವೆ ಏನಾಗ್ತವೆ ಅನ್ನೋದ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ನಾವು ಹೇಳಿ. ಘಟ್ಟ ಒಂದು ಮೆಟ್ರೋಪಾಲಿಟನ್ ಸಿಟಿಗೆ ತುಂಬ ಹತ್ರ ಇದೆ, ಒಂದು ಹೆಮ್ಮೆ ವಿಚಾರ. ಇಡೀ ಏಷ್ಯಾದಲ್ಲೇ ಒಂದು ಮೆಟ್ರೋಪಾಲಿಟನ್ ಸಿಟಿಗೆ ಹತ್ರ ಇರೋ ನಗರ ಅಂತ ಇದು ತುಂಬ ನಮಗೆಲ್ಲ ಹೆಮ್ಮೆ ಅಂತ ಅನಿಸುತ್ತೆ. ಆದರೆ ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಕಡೆ ನೋಡಿದ್ರೆ ತುಂಬ ದುಃಖ ಕೂಡ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ಸೊ ಆ ವಿಚಾರನ ಹೇಳ್ತೀನಿ. ಮತ್ತೆ ಅದ್ರ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ನಾನು ಹೇಳಬೇಕು, ನಮ್ಮ ಮೇಕೆದಾಟು ಪ್ರಾಜೆಕ್ಟ್.
So Murli's must work for a long time, for over decades, on particularly on olive green bay turtles, which travel thousands of kilometers and come to Indian coast to lay eggs and the hatchlings go back to the sea. So Murli, what is your take on reservations? Like, say for example, how does the coast, particularly the marine systems, feature in the conversations about biodiversity? Because there is a lot of emphasis when it comes to climate change and the sea and the oceans. So what is your thoughts?
Actually, I agree. I think what interested me in the post, especially in biodiversity, is the marine systems is something that always had an impact on the needs. They were always tracked, like nobody calls it oligosemantic circuits. A fish, it's like a key, fruits from a tree. It's a very different system that way. But then there's also like large flagships, like turtles and whales, which, you know, like, sorry, there's a distinction over there. But it's also a space which has had a lot of space with people. And the dialogue on climate change and, you know, like what parts of land is going to get affected. The posts were one of the sites that, you know, which immediately was visible. As in all predictions that come up, talk about how much land they're going to lose, on our posts, like large cities, half Mumbai, Chennai, the Sundar Nafsumir. So it's actually been a very interesting interface because yes, the world is a lot of paddles, turtles, which fascinated me, have been around for millions of years, right? Where it was a studied evolution, like they've gone through very, very large scale climatic events in the past and have succeeded in a few species. There are only seven zebras, extinct zebras right now. They've gone through several of these years. So at the moment, what we are doing in my work is we have to look at how these species have been adapting, like what's happening. Of course, like the dialogue, obviously, you know, things are going to get worse. At least from the context I've seen in India, like, okay, what is our better labs, testing rubies, things seem to be okay though. Predictions seem to indicate at worst, like worsening, like models that you look at, things might get better. What we really are talking about is not that things, where most of these models talk about a constant increase. They're not talking about the unpredictability. And that's something that we've been seeing across the coast even in the last 5 years. Like the frequency of cyclones that you observe, the 9 minutes we come in. Is crazy. Like I've not seen cyclones within the near Edward district that's happening, but other than Gujarat, I've already forgotten. There was like, it happened a few months ago. There was a massive cutting in Gujarat first of course. So I think we need to, like, the good thing about working in conservation and also being trained in ecology and being interested in the Indian Association, you always go back at night in history, like, you can admit that it seems. So, if turtles are always go back at a billion year old evolutionary scale, but if I look at what's happening in terms of development, it's happening right now. And whether it's time to give it, say, how there will be plans or it. I think we have been doing that over time. That a lot of things that we're talking about right now is mitigation, but now that's more becoming into an active step because climate change is inevitable. How we're going to adapt to it and how things are mitigated. Some species might get extinct, but we don't really know how it's going to extinct. Orchids are a fantastic example. They crashed. Completely apartment, they do it unserved. Like, if one in the pretty birds, as I say, like one would see black kites right now. That's how we would have seen vultures 20 years ago. It's only after they crashed that they became an important species. So, I think we don't really need to, I think with this audience, I think we don't really need to wait for those drastic changes before we start taking action. There's so much that happened in the cities and the spaces that we shared. That we need to start looking at every day and give them all the same importance. That's a challenge that I face myself always to this. I know you always introduce me and nobody who also has sea turtles, but I think sea turtles are interesting, but I think everything else is also interesting. So, yeah.
I just wanted to add, so basically, you brought up a really important point. So, I'm sure all of you are aware of this, but the minute you say climate change or environmental change, you think of warming. Because often we use the term warming and climate change. But what Murali talked about is actually the kinds of effects that in South Asia and in Asia in general, we're going to see a lot more, not just of warming, but unpredictable extreme weather events, right? And this is true generally also. It's not only in South Asia, globally, extreme weather events are becoming much more frequent. Now, the problem with extreme weather events is, just like the pandemic, they have a massive economic impact, right? They have a massive impact on, like, it's just a disaster, right? And disasters are huge negative impacts. The problem with environment, whether it's climate change, biodiversity loss, is it's all negative. So, for example, you try to convince a policymaker, you try to convince a politician about the value of the environment, you're actually getting a lot of stuff free right now, and it crashes and you lose money, right? So it's very difficult to, there's a lot of negative externalities. It's difficult to convince about the future. You're saying you just have to, you know, conserve things so that you don't lose more later. So that's something which is, so that way cities, sorry, it's a bit of a long-winded thing, but cities actually are really important spaces. We know that India is urbanizing. In the next 50 years, most of Indians will live in cities. And cities provide a template because we can plan them a bit better if we choose to do so. We could create small mini environments which could be resilient. This is what's happening all over Europe, for example. Semi-resilient spaces, because cities are an ecosystem in their own. They become heat islands, and they have their own weather dynamics. And so it might be an interesting thing to think about, especially from all of you, most probably as you are working adults, you're going to most probably live in cities. Maybe some of you will go and live in rural India or elsewhere. But it's something that we should really think about, is city planning and how to mainstream biodiversity in the context of that. Sorry if I spoke too much.
No issues. I just want to ask you also this, is there any kind of a, you have worked with this systems where you were doing the genetics work and which allow you to look back in time, just seeing the using their fecal material, you can look back. So is there something that you want to share with us which kind of surprised you as and which allows you to understand the past diversity or diversity of populations or or landscapes where there are similar populations when you have looked at, could find a signature.
So that's a great question. Shubho mentioned that I work on genetics, right? So basically, the amazing thing about DNA is it's really stable, right? And I don't know whether you guys saw, but last year, the Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine, of all things, went to Swante Pabo, who is basically a scientist who's, sequenced DNA of archaic humans, of Neanderthals, of Denisovans and so on, right? And the thing is that understanding the past is really helpful. Just as we study history to understand, how have past, social changes, political movements changed the world, and that would give us a window into how we can think about the future. So similarly, we can study evolution, not just by looking at the present, by going back in time. We can do time travel by looking at genetic material from these subfossils and so on. And there's really interesting things like in the last 100 years, there's been significant warming, right? So you can actually look at, during this time, were certain types of genetic variants more likely to survive, say, if you compare the past to now, and you can actually see whether there's certain, adaptations, genetic adaptations, which allow certain individuals or species to survive in the context of climate change. Like some things are very bad, they will not survive. For example, pikas, they're these lagomorphs, they're basically rabbits, rabbit family, and they only live in the cold. The minute you warm them up, they just explode, they cannot take it. Or yaks, I'm sure some of you might have seen yaks, they cannot tolerate the heat. So I think that this looking back in time allows you to look at that. And what's actually surprising is, sometimes it's not, we think that there must be some very unique and wonderful genetic variant which allows you to survive. But actually, a lot of times, it's also movement. So what we find is that there are signatures that, one particular population, they may not have survived, but somebody else came from somewhere else. And they brought some new genetic diversity, and that allowed the population to continue. So that's why these discussions of connectivity and so on are important, because if there is no scope for that movement, again, the chances of extinction become high. Thanks.
Yeah, so I don't want to ask too controversial question here. Otherwise, I would have asked this question that, how doomed the cheetahs of India would be, because from a population perspective, but let's mull away. We have enough material also to eat. But I wanted to ask you, Manu,
about you weren't working in Karnataka. So you were often having this in situation when there is a conflict that we all understand. So part of it is connected with what Noah was also mentioning about movement. Movement is connected. We had earlier the corridors. So corridors are the encroachment of the only conflict just here. So what is your experience working in particularly in the areas where there is a population pressure, human population pressure is there, and some of these areas are also corridors. So what is your experience working in such an area? Can you just briefly tell? Then I want to move to also the resilient part, because Bully had brought one important point that it's not a heading towards doom still, but there is conversation beyond that.
We've all heard Ashwata talking about it, right? He says in Bandhavgarh currently we still have one tiger that's seen quite frequently. And imagine this Bandhavgarh forest that we get to see is connected with our CWMS, that's Kaveri Wildlife Sanctuary. And imagine the number of tigers and the wildlife population that it could actually help with, right? That's basically what's missing with the connectivity. The forest is all now in pockets. If you go from Banagada towards Kanakpura, it's all in pockets. It's urbanized, semi-urbanized in between, and there's a forest in between. So you positive can see leopard movement happening here and there. But for a tiger to move even more easily, you need to have a connectivity happening from these two great areas, right? So that is why it becomes very important for the connectivity to sustain. That's one thing. And also in Bandhavgarh we get to see slender loris. So there was urban mapping also that happened a few years ago. A lot of students and citizen scientists actually took part in it to map how many slender loris that we get to see within the urban area, right? And we got to see them in IIC area, and mostly you get to see them in Bandhavgarh. Imagine again, if we had a good connectivity between the parks, right? So I hear some time back that there was a plan back then, many years ago, that Lal Bagh and Kabban Park they wanted to make it a connectivity between these two parks. Imagine if even that kind of connectivity had occurred, the biodiversity could have helped. Let's say, simply put across slender loris example, that would definitely had a better option there. So that's one thing. And as Manu was talking about, whatever that we have gone through, it's past. So now looking ahead, how do we improve these urban setups? We have enough data already. We already have something called State of India's Birds, the recently published one. And the ducks and lot of analytics are actually going on a deep decline, including the Great Indian Bustard, right? So considering all this data, if we can learn something out of it and make it a better habitat for all of these to thrive enough, I think we'll be in a better position.
Thanks. I'll open up the space for some questions. If you have any question, you kindly raise your hand.
Maybe even a revolution in Bangalore, you could talk about that, but I totally agree with you. But I think we're living in an individualistic society right now, but maybe I'm being too cynical and pessimistic.
So possibly just an extension of this question could be that how inequality in society contributes to climate change, on which there are a lot of films, a lot of engagement, and also people are doing a lot of work on this. Do we want to respond to the question? Or should we? I think it's a bit of a large question. So I'd like to also take some questions if there are students who would like to ask. Any of you would like to ask? Yeah.
Sir, good afternoon. So when we're talking about the protection of biodiversity, we have forest schools, national parks, and also wildlife sanctuaries where human invasion is completely not allowed. But I think it is also important to protect human beings too, right? Precisely tribes, those who live in the forest, now are like kicked out in the name of land acquisition and land alienation. So my question is, on what basis we are prioritizing to give protection on certain species? Because Homo sapiens as a species in the living world, we need to protect like us too, right? So and I think if we protect tribes and their culture, we can preserve our diversity too. Thank you.
Fantastic question. I think the dialogue in conservation has changed so much over the last couple of decades, and this has been a conundrum for me when I started up. Again, I'm bringing back the oceans and the coasts with the systems that I worked in. For example, I'm on a city bus. I grew up in Chennai. I don't know much. Like, I went out to field and I couldn't get out into the sea without a fishing community member taking me out. I had read everything that was available to me on all of Ridley Cousins and whatever. But that access and the knowledge to the region came from the people I worked with on ground. And the change that I want to make in terms of conservation should also affect them positively. And I do believe the dialogue around conservation has changed effectively. Even in terms of laws and legislation and the importance of communities living alongside natural systems. There is still a bit of, I think this connects, because that itself is a revolution in the way people are thinking. It is still an issue, but I think that has changed. And I think mainly what is happening is, urban society has lost its connect with nature a lot. Like, that much that you can learn, but only when you go out there, like, I've changed the way that I think also. Like, I don't think I need to go and do outreach on conservation for communities living next to forests. I think they know more about those landscapes and how to protect them than me. And I think that really has evolved over time. And I think that probably could be one of the things, but that dialogue needs to move across society. Like, it's always been a top-down conservation model, and I think that's really changing with time.
To that question, here's the answer, basically. Right? I say that because he grew up right in the fringes of forest. And he's now a Dr. Ashwata talking here about all the implications that might happen and the advantages that he can bring in as a part of that community, right? So it's a two-way street. That's basically what I'd like to believe. So it should happen from the people in the fringes as well to ensure that the forest, basically, I mean, before that, as ma'am was telling earlier, when we start to answer the biodiversity question, let's start with saying biodiversity is us. We are part of that web, very simply put, right? So we are the ones who should be taking care of that, firstly. And with whatever that power that we have within our limits, that's something that we'll have to leverage and do the best for the community and the place that we come from. So that's basically what WCG does as a group.
Yeah, I just get a very simple answer to that. So basically, conservation is a very legal field, right? And what species are protected, at what level, at what financial cost is determined by some, this is just the logical answer. By the endangerment status, so which is set by the International Union for the Conservation of Nature, IUCN, and they have criteria by which they suggest that a species is critically endangered, endangered, vulnerable, not at risk, and so on, right? And then there are internal, within a country, laws, like in India, it's the Wildlife Protection Act. The Wildlife Protection Act is more of a punitive act. It punishes you, it doesn't really do much. Apart from the tiger, there's no conservation, and some extent the elephant and now snow leopard, I guess. There's no conservation plans for species. It is more about if you are caught with species X, which is on schedule 1, then you suffer jail time for Y years. Okay? It's like that. So it's a punitive act. It's not really an act which is positive because it's based on this old British hunting kind of idea. that anything which you do in terms of accessing species is about hunting. So just to say that, so that's why, for example, defining species, defining biodiversity, categorizing species is all important from a scientific perspective, because that is what affords them protection. Remember that these species are voiceless, right? So of course, you know, humans are incredibly important, but I'm not disagreeing with anything you've said or that Murli has said. There should also be someone who speaks for nature.
I had one question for Dr. Ashwani Bhanuprakash, sir. I'm not from Bangalore, so I wanted to understand in or around Banerghatta National Park if there are species within the communities, members who are living there still, that are not there, that they don't see anymore. Like you mentioned, there used to be more tigers, now it's just down to one tiger. So other species like that, where there used to be more and historically and now there's none or quite less, or the opposite also, where there were historically species that were not present in the area and now because of some changes they have traveled to that area. So
as far as my understanding goes, what we see is more of a loss than what is actually gained. Because when I get to hear the stories, I'm actually not from Banerghatta, I'm from the urban area, but still I work with these guys. And when I get to hear the stories, I hear the stories where they used to see the elephant right from their bedroom in the night. And that's not going to happen anymore. Right? So that's how the difference is currently. So that's basically what my take on that is.
ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ಸ್ಕೇಪು ಮತ್ತು ಈಗಿರೋ ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ಸ್ಕೇಪು ಕಂಪೇರ್ ಮಾಡಿದರೆ ಎಷ್ಟೊಂದು ಬದಲಾವಣೆ ಆಗಿದೆ. ಮೊದಲು ಹೇಳ್ತಿದೆ ಇದರಲ್ಲಿ ಕುರ್ಚಿಲ್ ಕಾಡಿತ್ತು ಮತ್ತು ಎಷ್ಟೊಂದು ಗ್ರಾಸ್ ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಥರ ಇತ್ತು 1970s ಹಿಂದೆ. ಸೊ ಆವಾಗ ಹೈನಾ ನೋಡ್ತಿದ್ವಿ, ಆಮೇಲೆ ಜೋಕಲ್ಸ್ ಇತ್ತು, ಆಮೇಲೆ ಉಲ್ಫ್ ಇತ್ತು, ಆಮೇಲೆ ವಲ್ಚರ್ಸ್ ಇತ್ತು. ಸೊ ಯಾಕೆಂದರೆ ಅದು ಆ ಥರ ಕುರ್ಚಿಲ್ ಥರ ಕಾಡಿದ್ದಿದ್ದರಿಂದ ಮತ್ತು ಗ್ರಾಸ್ ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಥರ ಇದ್ದಿದ್ದರಿಂದ ಇತ್ತು. ಯಾವಾಗ ವೆಜಿಟೇಷನ್ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಬಂತು, ಎಲಿಫೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಬಂತು. ಸೊ ಆಮೇಲೆ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಈಗ ಒಂದು ದೊಡ್ಡ ಕಾಡಲ್ಲಿ ಏನೆಲ್ಲ ಇರಬೇಕಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಅದೆಲ್ಲ ಇದೆ, ಕೆನಾಯಿಂದ ಇದ್ದು ಎಲ್ಲ ಇದೆ. ಆದರೆ ಆಶ್ಚರ್ಯ ಏನಪ್ಪ ಅಂದರೆ ಆವಾಗ ಯಾವಾಗ ಹೈನಾ ಆಗಲಿ ಅಥವಾ ತೋಳ ಆಗಲಿ ಜೋಕಲ್ ಆಗಲಿ ಇವೆಲ್ಲ ಈಗಿಲ್ಲ. ಗ್ರೇ ಜೋಕಲ್ ನಾನು ಒಂದು 7-8 ವರ್ಷದಿಂದ ನೋಡಿದ್ದೆ, ಬಟ್ ಅದು ಯಾರೋ ಶೂಟ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಬಿಟ್ಟೋಗಿದ್ರು, ಆ ಥರದ್ದು ನೋಡಿದ್ದೆ. ಅದೇ ಲಾಸ್ಟ್ ನೋಡಿದ್ದು, ಮತ್ತೆ ಎಲ್ಲೂ ಸಿಗಲಿಲ್ಲ ನನಗೆ. ಇವನ್ ನಾವು ಬಂಡರ್ಘಟ್ಟ ನ್ಯಾಷನಲ್ ಪಾರ್ಕಲ್ಲಿ ಕ್ಯಾಮ್ರಾ ಡ್ರಾಪ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ, ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ಕೂಡ ನಮಗೆ ಸಿಗಲಿಲ್ಲ. ಲೆಪರ್ಡ್ ಪಾಪ್ಯುಲೇಷನ್ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿದೆ, 50+ ಆತ ಇದೆ. ಸಂಜೆ ಗುಬ್ಬೆ ಹಂಟಿಂಗ್ ಸಭೆ ಮಾಡಿ ಲೆಪರ್ಡ್ ಪಾಪ್ಯುಲೇಷನ್ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿದೆ. ಸೊ ಈ ಥರ ಬದಲಾವಣೆ ಆಗಿದೆ, ಹೊಸದಂತ ಏನಿಲ್ಲ. ಹನಿ ಬರ್ಜರ್ ಮಾತ್ರ ಒಂದ್ಸರಿ ಕ್ಯಾಮ್ರಾಗೆ ಸಿಕ್ಕಿದೆ, ಅದು ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಆಶ್ಚರ್ಯ ಪಡ್ಬಹುದು.
So when we say Kuchil Kadu search, of course, so it used to support hyenas, jackals, wolves back then, but that is something that's got missing today. As he was telling, most surprisingly, we got to see a honey badger recently through a camera trap that was done. So that's one of the positives maybe from this comment of ours.
So we'd like to just wind up, but I feel that, you know, one thing we are discussing about biodiversity and climate resilience, but I cannot reconcile with the fact that it would be not really, in my mind, right, if we really don't point out some of the recent amendments to the Biodiversity Act, just to make it a point that, you know,
is something that many of the conservationists, wildlife biologists, scientists, social scientists who are working in the forest have raised their apprehension. Here we have also Dr. Ram Chandra Guha, who had worked earlier on ecological history. And we could see this through these many scholarly articles and books, we could understand that India has a long history of biodiversity protection and somewhat a reflective history post-independence about biodiversity conservation. So, any of you would like to comment on the recent, amendments? I don't want to put it in a place, just I wanted to ask anybody who want to comment on that. Or like future of biodiversity legislation.
I think it will be a long conversation. So, yes, there's a lot of critique that's gone out, and in a sense, let's put it this way, the amendments coming in after so long to make changes to things that are very rigid, I think, whatever, because I'm also optimistic in many ways, I think it is a good thing that, that finally they're making some changes to it. Like, otherwise, Wildlife Protection Act, Biodiversity Act, it was written and accepted in stone with problems in it that we had struggled with. I think, again, since I also believe in democracy, if we find something wrong with it, there is hope that we can change the smaller issues that continue to move. I think a lot of conservation action, especially around biodiversity, has purely been seen from an animal rights lens or a nature protection lens, but I think the human right aspect and that is coming in slowly. There are more submissions coming in about that in terms of the treaty. So even though it's not changed, but at least I'm happy to see much of that coming through. So I think in that sense, it's only when something wrong goes up that we will spark a revolution or thought around it. So I think I will still take that as a positive. I hope that we can change many of those issues.
So, thank you very much, all of you. Thank you, Murli. Thank you, Uma. Thank you.
I would like to thank our panelists for such a...
One more question is that. In the era of gender, how many people are creating busted knowledge? How many people? Great Indian Bustard, Yaradru Nodi Grash generally, Yaradru Nodi the Kaiti. So now Adana Noda on the Rakbeko. Even Nanakuda and Field of Kodaga, Yadgirali, more Bustard Nodi. ಮತ್ತೆ ಇದ್ರ ಮೇಲೆ ಕೆಲವರೆಲ್ಲ ತುಂಬ ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಸೊ ಅವುಗಳದ್ದು ಹ್ಯಾಬಿಟೆಟ್ ಉಳಿಸ್ಕೊಳ್ಳೋಕ್ಕೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಪ್ರಯತ್ನಗಳೆಲ್ಲ ಆಗಬೇಕು. ಸೊ ನಾನು ಒಂದು ವಿಚಾರ ಹೇಳೋಕ್ಕೆ ಇಷ್ಟಪಡ್ತೀನಿ ಈ ಟೈಮಲ್ಲಿ. ಹಾವೇರಿನಲ್ಲಿ ರಾಣಿಬನ್ನೂರು ಬ್ಲಾಕ್ ಬರ್ಡ್ ಸೆಂಚುರಿ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ನಾನು ವಿಸಿಟ್ ಮಾಡಿದಾಗ ಒಂದು ಪ್ರಾಜೆಕ್ಟ್ ನಡೀತಾ ಇತ್ತು, ಗ್ರಾಸ್ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಪ್ರಾಜೆಕ್ಟ್. ನನ್ನ ಫೀಲ್ಡ್ ವರ್ಕ್ ಹೋದಾಗ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಸೊ ನಾನು ಅಬ್ಸರ್ವ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದು ಅದೇನಂದರೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿರೋ ವೆಜಿಟೇಷನ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ರಿಮೂವ್ ಮಾಡಿಬಿಟ್ಟು ಗ್ರಾಸ್ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಮಾಡೋದು ಅಂತ ಪ್ರಾಜೆಕ್ಟ್. ಸೊ ಏನು ಮಾಡ್ತಾಯಿದ್ರು ಅಂದರೆ ಎಷ್ಟೊಂದು ಜೆ ಸಿ ಬಿಗಳು ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡ್ತಾಯಿದ್ವು, ನೇಟಿವ್ ಸ್ಪೀಸೀಸ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ರಿಮೂವ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ರು, ಇಕ್ಯುಲಿಪ್ಟಿಸ್ ಮಾತ್ರ ಉಳಿಸಿದ್ರು. ಸೊ ಇದು ಗ್ರೇಟ್ ಇಂಡಿಯನ್ ಬಸ್ಟಾರ್ಡ್ಗೆ ನಾವು ಕೊಡ್ತಾ ಇರೋ ಪ್ರಾಜೆಕ್ಟ್ಸ್. ಸೊ ಈ ಪ್ರಾಜೆಕ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಈ ಥರದವನ್ನ ನಾವು ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಯೋಚನೆ ಮಾಡಬೇಕಾಗುತ್ತೆ. ಸೊ ಇಷ್ಟೊಂದು ಜನ ಇದ್ದೀವಿ ನಾವು, ನಮಗೆ ಇವಾಗ ತಾನೇ ನಾವು ಇಷ್ಟೊಂದು ಲಾ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಹ್ಯಾಕ್ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಎಲ್ಲ ನಾವು ಮಾತಾಡೋಕ್ಕೆ ಶುರು ಮಾಡಿದ್ವಿ. ನನಗನ್ಸಿದ್ದು ಎಷ್ಟೊಂದು ಟೈಮಲ್ಲಿ ನನ್ನ ಇದರಲ್ಲಿ ನಾನು ಸಜೆಸ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡೋದು ಏನಂದರೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಕೈಯಲ್ಲಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಇಲ್ಲ ಗೊತ್ತಿಲ್ಲ, ಗ್ರಾಸ್ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ಗೆ ಮತ್ತು ಗ್ರಾಸ್ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಹ್ಯಾಬಿಟೇಟ್ಗೆ ಮತ್ತು ಅಲ್ಲಿರೋ ಬಯೋಡೈವರ್ಸಿಟಿಗೆ ಉಳಿಸ್ಕೊಳ್ಳೋಕ್ಕೆ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಒಂದು ಪ್ರತ್ಯೇಕವಾಗಿರೋ ಏನಾದರೂ ಲಾ ಮಾಡ್ಬೋದಾ? ಈ ಕ್ವಶನ್ ನಮ್ಮ ತಲೆಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಇರಲಿ. ಸೊ ಆ ಚಾನ್ಸ್ ಯಾರಿಗಾದರೂ ಸಿಕ್ಕಿದ್ರೆ ಖಂಡಿತ ಮಾಡಿ, ಗ್ರಾಸ್ ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ಸ್ನ ಉಳಿಸ್ಕೊಳ್ಬೋದು. ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು.